Thank you, Diana, and good evening, everyone. It's wonderful to see so many familiar faces. I've had the pleasure of working with the Sierra Club and the Farm Bureau for a number of years as pathfinders on a number of ag-related topics and as well as water quality projects, and it's been fun to be able to continue that into my new venture here at the Chamber as well. One thing I wanted to mention, I, as a farm girl and with water quality being near and dear to my heart, both my work at Pathfinders, kind of an interesting adage I heard when I started the Chamber was, if you've seen one chamber, you've seen one chamber. And in thinking about tonight, if you've seen or met one farmer, you've met one farmer. Every farmer is different, every farm is different, and so I am really grateful for our panel tonight that's going to give us a glimpse into several different farms and their operations and give us a little glimpse into what they do day to day. So what I'd like to do is we're going to first meet, the way the program's going to go tonight is we're going to meet our panelists that are going to be responding to the presentation by Francis in a moment, and we'll learn just a little bit about who they are and a little bit about their operation, and I'll introduce Francis Thicke to give his presentation, and then after that we'll have a chance for our farmers to respond, and then we will have some questions and answers from there. Joe Ledger, can you tell us a little bit about your operation, where your farm is? I think you use the microphone, that'd be awesome. Thank you.
I live out northwest of Fairfield, farm around 950 acres, corn and soybeans. I'm a lifelong resident of Jefferson County, born and raised here. And I do a lot of no-tilling and cover crops. Been getting into it a little more each year. I guess that's about all I got to say about this.
Great, thank you.
Next we have Jim
Flinspa. Jim? My name is Jim Flinspa. I farm north of town on Highway 1. I farm a family operation, about at least a fourth generation farmer that I've checked on so far anyhow. Our operation is corn and soybeans. We have no-till planting, tile intake terraces, and I'm just beginning to experiment with some cover crops.
Jeremy Atwood.
Yep, I'm Jeremy Atwood. Live with my wife and two boys northwest of town, about 7 miles on Packwood Road. Many of you probably know us as the pumpkin and Christmas tree farm.
Yeah.
we also raise corn and soybeans, a few oats and alfalfa, do some rye for some neighbors. Also raise hogs and sheep. I think I'm a fifth generation Jefferson County farmer.
Thank you. All right, thank you very much, gentlemen, and thank you again for joining us this evening. So next, we're going to be hearing a presentation from Francis Thicke, who I think is no stranger among us. Francis and his wife Susan own and operate a 90-cow grass-based organic dairy near Fairfield. And they process their milk on their farm and market all of their dairy products in through restaurants and grocery stores all within Fairfield. Francis also has a PhD in soil fertility, and he served as a national program leader for the soil science for the USDA Extension Service in Washington, D.C. prior to his arrival here in Fairfield. So please join me in welcoming Francis.
Thank you, Deidre. It's really nice to be here and to have so many people here. And I'm really pleased that you guys came along too, so it's going to make it more interesting, I think, and fun. So we're going to talk about the Iowa Nutrient Reduction Strategy, which you've probably heard a lot about, water quality in Iowa. But actually, it goes back to a national thing, a national initiative, the Gulf Hypoxia Action Plan, because we all know that down when the Mississippi River drains into the Gulf of Mexico, there is every summer a huge dead zone, hypoxia zone. And that's caused by the nutrients that come down the river, cause the algae to bloom, And then when the algae die, the decomposition robs all the oxygen out of the water, and so it gets, the sea life can't live there. Either they have to leave, or all those that are immobile can't, they die. And usually it gets about the size of Connecticut or in the big years, Massachusetts. And so that's what really is the impetus behind the whole water quality initiative here in Iowa. In 2008, they had an action plan, and the goal was to reduce the 5-year running average size of the zone to less than 1,900 square miles, about the size of Rhode Island. In the last couple of years, though, it's been about 6,000 square miles, sometimes 7,000. And so the EPA has the authority under the Clean Water Act to mandate the states take action. And if the states do not take action, the EPA can actually take away the authority to regulate water quality and can do it from the national level, which is not something we want to have happen, of course. And this is kind of a summary from the U.S. Geological Survey of the nutrients that come down to the Gulf. Phosphorus and nitrogen are the two nutrients that are generally the culprit in water quality problems. And we'll talk a little more about that later. But for phosphorus, we can see agriculture contributes 80% of the phosphorus that comes down the river. And corn and soybeans is 25%, other crops 18%, pasture and range 37%. And phosphorus tends to stick to the soil particles. And so phosphorus tends to be something that's a problem where there's erosion. The phosphorus goes to the soil particles into the lakes and rivers. And phosphorus is usually a problem in lakes, and nitrogen usually a problem in rivers. And we'll see why in a minute here. Now, on the nitrogen side, agriculture contributes 72% of the nitrogen, but most of it comes from corn and soybean production in the Mississippi River Basin. And we're going to see why that is in a bit, and a few other parts from other crops and pasture and so on. But the urban part really is relatively small compared to the agriculture's contribution. And I mentioned that phosphorus is usually the problem in lakes, in nitrogen rivers. So the idea of a limiting nutrient is nitrogen is the one that causes the dead zone to grow as more nitrogen comes down. This whole idea of a barrel with staves, and the shortest stave is what limits the in a case might be a crop, or in this case, the growth of the dead zone, like algae. And so as more nitrogen comes down the river, this stave goes up higher, and so there's more nitrogen available for the algae to grow, more bodies, more to multiply out and get bigger and bigger. So nitrogen is the limiting nutrient for the growth of the dead zone. And we know that in all over the Midwest, most of the good cropland is tile drain. About 4 feet down, there's a drainage system that takes the water, the excess water, out and onto ditches and into streams and rivers and on to the Gulf of Mexico. So that is one of the issues. Now, in the nitrogen Iowa nutrient reduction strategy, the goal is to reduce in Iowa the riverine nitrogen and phosphorus by 45% to meet that national goal. And they've done a science assessment of the whole state and various aspects of it, and look at what's from point sources and what's from non-point. And point sources are usually like municipalities, their wastewater treatment plants, so on. They have a point source that comes out into the river. And so that's a relatively small amount of the nitrogen and more of the phosphorus. And for agriculture, non-point sources, Iowa State University says that 93% of it comes from agriculture, the nitrogen that goes into the rivers, and 79% of the phosphorus. And now for the point sources, municipalities and so on, they're regulated, and so there's going to be a tightening up of the regulation, more enforcement of it, and so that is kind of on track. For agriculture, it's a voluntary thing, and so we're kind of scrambling to see how we can meet that goal. So for nitrogen, for agriculture, the goal is to reduce our nitrogen load by 41% and the phosphorus load by 29%. So this is kind of a key thing that we'll come back to as we go along here. And we can see what's happened over the years from 1986 up to the current time. This is the Raccoon River up by Des Moines, where the Des Moines Water Works gets its drinking water from, and you've all heard about that and the lawsuit and so on, and you've probably heard that the lawsuit's been dismissed now by a court. So you can see there's been an upward trend. This is data from the U.S. Geological Survey and the DNR, an upward trend over this time, but it varies greatly year by year, depending upon if there's a drought or excess rainfall and how the two interact and so on. So there seems to be a trend that we're not really improving it over time. Although sometimes there's some publicity's gone out claiming contrary to that. For example, a couple of years ago, one organization claimed that the nitrogen level is going down from 2006 to 2013. It went down from 9 parts per million to 5 parts per million. So they only took that little segment, and it got a lot of statewide press. So we have to be careful when you hear about data like this, if it's really what some scientists would call cherry picking. You know, we saw this little blip here, and if you publicize that part and not the whole thing, you can kind of pick data out and get what you want as a result. And you've heard a lot about cover crops, and we're going to probably hear more as we go along here. And they play a key role here. And the reason why, we'll see, is that, backing up here again, is that people think often, well, we have too much nitrogen in the river, we just need to use less nitrogen fertilizer. But that's not really the case. Actually, it's kind of counterintuitive that most of the nitrogen that gets in the river is not from fertilizer. It's from the whole dynamic soil system. And so that's what makes it very complicated. And so it's, even I think a lot of our politicians don't understand the process. And so it's not that difficult, but it's a little counterintuitive. And the thing is that the predominant cropping system in Iowa, corn and soybeans, covers 2/3 of the land surface of Iowa every year. And the problem is that, for nitrogen, is that corn and soybeans only have live roots in the soil for about 5 months of the year. And during the rest of the year, there are no live roots in the soil. So remember the tile drainage, when water, rainfall comes, it percolates into the soil, down to that tile drains, and out to the river. And nitrate is very soluble, and it will go right with it. Now, when there are live roots there, when the corn is growing vigorously, there is really very rarely any kind of a nitrate problem. So the live roots will scavenge that nitrogen. And actually, research shows that when prairies, for example, that have roots year-round, they will leach very little nitrogen. Almost no nitrogen can escape from the prairie system. And this is kind of some study from Minnesota from a while back, but the same system that we see today, looking at how much nitrogen over a 4-year period came out of the tile drains. And first of all, the concentration for the continuous corn, it was 28 parts per million coming out of the tile drain on average. Corn, soybeans, 23 on the various phases of the rotation. But interestingly, where we have perennials in the landscape, live roots in the soil year-round, alfalfa, only 1.6 pounds parts per million of nitrate was coming out. For CRP, which is grass, only 0.7. And so when there are perennial roots in there, when there are perennial crops, live roots year-round, there's really no loss, virtually no loss. And you look at the total for the 4 years, 194 pounds came out of the corn soybean, and CRP only 4 pounds, like almost 50 times less. And what's really interesting is that the rotation of corn and soybeans leak almost as badly as the continuous corn. And other research has shown that soybeans leak nitrate about as bad as corn, which is kind of counterintuitive because soybeans generally do not get any nitrogen fertilizer. They produce their own through nodules. And so it's not the fertilizer per se that's causing the problem, it's the system that is inherently leaky. And that's why cover crops come in and help solve that problem. And this is an excellent cycle. I just threw that out there, you can't hardly see it anyway. But this is to show how the dynamics of nitrogen is so incredible compared to other nutrients that it's very difficult to control. But I'm going to take that apart and just look at a few parts of it in the cycle. And one is the form that a fertilizer that we mostly see is ammonia, anhydrous ammonia. You've seen applications in the field. And what happens then, and that's a gas, it's compressed gas. When it's injected in the soil, the water around the soil particles will absorb it, dissolve it, and then it stays there. And then it quite quickly grabs hydrogen ions from the soil and becomes ammonia, NH4+. And the interesting thing about ammonium is that soil particles are negatively charged. And so the ammonium will be held by the soil particles, which means that it doesn't move very readily at all. But what happens in the soil, though, is that microorganisms very quickly, when it's warm enough, will change that ammonium to nitrate. And nitrate is a form you hear about all the time. You always hear people talking about nitrates, plural, but that's a misnomer. Scientists don't like that. It's nitrate. It's like saying two deers, you know. So this is the form that then this is the main form that crops take up. And it's also the form that leaches, because remember the soil has negative charges, and so that cannot be absorbed by the soil. When the rainfall comes, this ammonia will stay in the soil. but the nitrate will leach out with the water. And but the ammonium quickly changes. Microbes get energy by doing this transformation, so that changes the form pretty quickly. But now it isn't just for fertilizer, as I've been saying. Soil organic matter. There's a huge dynamics with soil organic matter. Nitrogen. The average productive soil in Iowa has about 10,000 pounds per acre of nitrogen in it, in the organic form. And it's very dynamically cycling. So that also goes through this process. And we're going to see it comes back again, back to the organic matter. It cycles around and around. And this is from Iowa State. They're a little schematic of how this happens. We just stay, this is the soil surface. We'll stay below the soil surface here. So good soil has about 10,000 pounds per acre of nitrogen in organic form. And of course, it can't leach in organic form. But microbes are constantly cycling that. Microbes that take here 100 to 400 pounds of nitrogen from the organic matter into the nitrate form, and then a whole lot back into the organic matter. It cycles around and around. And so you can see how, when there's a perennial, like when the prairie was here, there were roots there all the time. And so when the nitrate was mineralized out, the plants would grab that. And then when the plants would die or roots would die off, they'd cycle it back in again, round and round, because the roots were live year-round. Now when we truncate that, we cut that off, and we have crops that only have live roots for 5 months of the year, then we have a huge opportunity for loss of nitrogen. So in Iowa State summed it up saying that on average then, we'll lose about 30 pounds of nitrogen per acre if we don't do any remedial practices. And the interesting thing is, as I mentioned, this is soybeans. The last one here back is corn. Now in the soybeans, it's a very similar process, but no fertilizer comes in. But yet, the losses are similar. And this kind of helps explain it more, is that this shows from the year early in spring till the next spring or winter. What happens in the soil? As the soil warms up, the rate of nitrate production from the native organic matter starts to take off. The warm soil, the microbes get active, they start to degrade organic matter and make nitrate. But that happens before the corn and soybeans are planted and begin to actively take up nitrogen. So there's this phase here where there's nitrogen there can be leached out. And this is where often we get a lot of leaching in the spring if the soils are saturated. And then when you get later in the summer, suddenly the corn is taking a lot of nitrogen, soybeans too, and they're taking more than the soil can produce. So here in this phase, we generally don't have any leaching. Now they're getting to the end of the life cycle of corn and soybeans, and suddenly they're no longer taking it up, and if it's still warm in the fall, we're producing more nitrate from the organic matter, so we have a leaching potential here again. So you can imagine if we put cover crops in here, at this point when the corn and soybeans are finishing their life cycle, put in cover crops, then they can grow and make another blip here and take up that nitrate and into the spring too as well, until corn planting time or soybean planting time. But we often don't see that in Iowa. We're just kind of getting onto it. I saw the most recent data shows that there are about 500,000 to 600,000 acres of cover crops on the ground this year. But we have 24 million acres of corn and soybeans, so we're a little behind the curve. And sometimes we see a lot of tillage over the winter too. And so this is when a lot of things can happen that aren't what we desire. I threw this little slide in from the Tractor Farmers of Iowa, who their little slogan is "Don't farm naked," and that's why cover crops can make a big difference, not only for nitrate leaching but for soil erosion as well. And an interesting thing just came out this last year: research at Iowa State and USDA Agricultural Research Service. They looked at conventional corn soybean rotation and how much nitrate was lost over 2 years. Was about 70 pounds per acre. And then for their organic system, it had alfalfa in it, perennial, and they lost about half as much nitrogen as the two with the annual crops, and the pasture had lost a whole lot less. So things, and that's what the science assessment shows, is what kinds of things can make a difference for the nitrate leaching. I think I missed a slide here. So besides cover crops, so there are things that they can be, at the end where the tunnel drain comes out and goes to the creek or the ditch, things that are used are like bioreactors and wetlands, and I'll show you a picture of a bioreactor, a wetland. What they do is they hold the water with the nitrate, and the microbes will denitrify that, turn that nitrate into back to the atmosphere. This is a bioreactor, so the tile drains from the field would come into this bioreactor. It's full of wood chips, and that will be the energy for the bacteria to change that nitrate to nitrogen gas. And of course, you can imagine this is pretty expensive to build, and it lasts about 20 years, from what I understand. Well, cover crops, if we can get them in early, I'm just going to show you something that I've been trying to do. And for some reason, there's some slides missing in here. One slide I'm thinking about is that the research shows that for cover crops, the average reduction in nitrate leaching is about 31%. And if you do if you keep the cover crop in until it gets taller, usually it gets killed at a shorter rate, shorter height. If you let it go taller, it's about 55% reduction in nitrate leaching. And if you do a better job of managing your nitrogen, instead of putting it all on the spring or all in the fall, if you split it up, then you can gain another 10% reduction in nitrate leaching. So just those two things.
What's your best cover crop?
Best cover crop? The most common one, the most studied one, I think, is sort of rye. And that's planted in the fall, as you know, and it goes through the winter. And that seems to be the best that it's been used. But more people are going to some kind of a mixture of cover crops, too, for diversity of species. So something that I try to do in my farm, and I farm right across the fence from Joe, and Joe's been putting all these cover crops, and I've been watching him for all these years here, and I've been impressed by it. And so that's a great thing. And so what I did is on some fields I had that were some old hay fields, not very productive, I planted cover crops early, cereal rye, and then I've got this little machine here called a roller crimper. And it rolls over, we wait till the rye gets tall, just ready to make a head. And then you roll over, it has crimper that crimps the stock every few inches. And so the plant will then lay flat. And so and then what we did is we came back in and planted soybeans right in that flat crop, and away it went. And I'm learning you need to have about 8,000 pounds per acre of the rye. If you don't have enough, you're going to get weeds. And I had some weeds. And I had some I knew I was going to get weeds, but I did it anyway. So I kind of calibrated my eye. So I had pretty good success on fields that had a lot of rye. This is one field that had some weeds back there. Okay. And another thing is, of course, perennials. The research shows that a perennial crop on the landscape will reduce nitrate leaching by about 85%. So that makes a difference, too. So what are the solutions? I'm going to quickly touch on a few things that I want to suggest. People have been talking about, so it's voluntary, and the objections people have is that we don't have enough participation. And that's been for a long time. I worked in water quality in Washington, D.C. in 1988, and that's when we launched a national water quality initiative, a voluntary initiative. We thought that would do it back then. So that's almost 30 years ago. So the other thing is that people say, well, we need regulation. The objection that is raised is that it's too inflexible. Every farm is unique, like Dietrich said. And so you can't have one size fits all. I mean, I wouldn't want somebody telling me I had to do some certain thing when I think something might work better for me. So what I was suggesting is, there are some things that one size does fit all. Grass waterways. I mean, every farmer knows that where the water collects in the waterways, we should have grass there. And when you drive around, you often see some places where it's not. Like these grass waterways here. That's pretty important to catch the soil and so on. If you don't have them, you can have some big problems in the big rainfall. And if you get a lot of water and you got a good grass waterway, it makes a big difference. And so you can see that these are an important thing. That one size does fit all there, I think. Another thing is buffer strips along streams. This is from the NRCS stock photo here, Sean. This is the extreme, of course, right up against the river. But if we have a buffer along the river, we can protect it a lot, and it can stop a lot of problems, especially phosphorus. Minnesota has a new law requiring up to a 50-foot buffer along every part of the lake, river, stream, and ditch in the state. That's a little controversial, but that's the step they've taken. So the Environment Working Group has suggested four things are what we should do all around. Buffers in all open waters, grass in all field waterways, no manure or frozen or snow covered ground, and no cattle standing in streams. For example, that you can see that's not a good thing, snow and manure and snow. And cattle, in the summertime, if you have them constantly in a stream, they're going to stand in there to get cool, and they're going to drop their manure in there. So some things, one size does fit all. But I wanted to talk about this briefly at the end. I think that there is a flexible opportunity for regulation to require every farm to have a water quality plan. And that would give flexibility. It's like a soil conservation plan. Now farmers who get money in the federal program and have highly rural land, they're required to participate to have a soil conservation plan on their farm. And so farmers are used to it. It's pretty commonplace. Maybe it's not enforced as well as it should be. But what happens is that farmers input into a computer program what their practices are, and it spits out an expected soil loss. It estimates the soil loss. And if you don't meet a T value, then you have to go back and change your practices, and then so you meet T. That's what you can use on your farm. So yeah, if it doesn't meet T, you've got to go back and add more conservation practices. We could do a very similar thing with water quality. We already have an extensive database on how farming practices affect water quality. It's in the IRA Nutrient Reduction Strategy, the science assessment. We could create a similar water quality model like for soil, like the universal soil loss equation. And we could create tolerance value, T values for nitrogen and for phosphorus, which would meet the statewide goals of an Iowa Nutrient Reduction Strategy. And so that could be applied on a farm level, which is 41% reduction in nitrogen, 29% reduction in phosphorus. And so the farm water quality plan would have to include practices that would meet the T for N and for T. So that's where I wanted to end.
All right, we'll invite all of our farmer guests up to the front here. Francis, you're going to have a seat up here as well. I guess we'll turn the light on the other side.
How you doing?
Good that you got a shirt.
Oh, yeah. Don't do that.
That's a lot of information in a short period of time. But it's really good. Yeah. Been working with a number of water quality projects with the Iowa Nutrient Reduction Strategy in my previous position, and you help clarify some things as you give that science behind it, so I appreciate it. So what I'd like to do next, our guests, Joe, Jim, and Jeremy haven't seen this presentation before, so we're hitting them a little cold, but we would just love to hear your thoughts, reactions, whatever they may be. Either of you have, I'll let you volunteer, I guess, as to who goes who first instead of putting you on the spot. Anybody? Thanks, Joe.
I guess I'll start. I was impressed with the presentation. I seen some things in there that I didn't realize, but there's a lot of things that I'm unfamiliar with, too.
Okay, Jim?
I guess I could echo that. T standard is kind of a moving target. You have a lot of different soil types out there, lots of things that have to be factored in, and the one size fits all, like he said, that won't work. And I'd like to stress that a voluntary program, I think, would be a lot better, using the carrot and the stick, not just the stick.
No, I would have to say that I would agree with a lot of your presentation, and I thought it was very well prepared. So, as farmers, I think, regulation is kind of a bad word to a lot of farmers. In our operation, we already follow several regulations. So, regulations can add cost.